thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Happy group this morning. This is the March 4th, 2019, 9 a.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five commissioners are present and ready to go. Vice Chair Boswell, would you lead us in the invocation and the pledge, please?
Please join me in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with thanksgiving and praise. Lord, it's just a wonderful thing to be able to come in this morning and see the flowers blooming and the trees with buds on them. It's just a reminder of your renewal, of your love for us each and every day. God, just be with us as we go about this meeting. Help us to make wise decisions for our county. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Next we have public speakers related to agenda items. Thank you. And I don't see any agenda-related items as far as people signing up, so we don't have any public speakers for that today, and therefore I guess we don't have any responses. So next, could we be seeking a motion for approval of the agenda?
Second.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, next is the consent agenda. If everybody has had the opportunity to review the items on the consent agenda.
Mm-hmm. I move that we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for approval of the consent agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. We have this morning a presentation I've been looking forward to for a while. Foxy Harper and Gail Miller. Are they here?
They are.
Right there you are, right in front of me. Y'all would please come on up, and y'all have an update about the North Carolina Senior Tar Heel Legislature.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Foxy Harper, and Dale Miller is the alternate to the Senior Tar Heel Legislature. And I'm hoping that you had a chance to look at some of the materials that were sent ahead, but we'll review them to make them hopefully applicable for you all and in your positions with our county. As the Alamance County delegate to the Senior Tar Heel Legislature, I'm here to talk about the legislative priorities that the Senior Tar Heel Legislature is advocating for this biennium. I want to show you, in a small degree, how the demographics on aging population in Alamance County correlate to those priorities and hopefully enlist your support of them. I believe that you have received this booklet, and I hope you've had a chance to look at some of the numbers because I'll be referring to those. This is an overview of the aging population and individuals with disabilities for Alamance County. And it's produced by the Area Agency on Aging, the Piedmont Triad Regional Commission. Let's look at some facts about the population of our county. I'm sure you're well aware of the rapid growth of our county and the growth projections that over the next 20 years, Alamance County is expected to grow by 47,525 total residents, of which 44%, approximately 22,000, will be age 60 or over. By 2036, one in four Alamance County residents will be over the age of 60. Projections for the Piedmont Triad region growth for the period from 2015 to 2035, reflecting both the number of older adults and the total population, indicate Alamance County is expected to continue to lead the 12-county region in the rate of growth. Ensuring adequate quality of services and care for this growing population is both a current need and requires planning and preparation for increasing needs. I'm sure that you are well aware aging comes with changes. Changes in health and the ability to function in many ways and on various levels. I think you would agree that remaining in our homes with as much autonomy as possible is our optimal goal. However, with declines in function that make independence more difficult, older adults can receive essential services that make the difference in allowing them to remain at home. Help with activities such as daily living, such as bathing, dressing, grooming, and with other needs such as house cleaning, laundry, cooking, shopping, transportation. All of these are key to having the choice of remaining at home. Our first priority is to increase funding for the Home and Community Care Block Grant. Home and community-based services are exactly those kinds of things that I was just referring to the needs of. They are the things that allow people to remain at home and to make their own choices. They can live with dignity and independence at a fraction of the cost of skilled nursing or other institutional settings. In your book, I refer you to page 5, which shows a comparison of county expenditures by services category for clients 60 plus. Home and community-based grant funding has not kept pace with the needs for service. As of this past September, there were 10,300 North Carolinians on waiting lists for those services. A large number, portion of that number are waiting for meals. Pretty scary to think that people are sitting in their homes hungry. Also, the funding has not been recurring, which makes for uncertainty from year to year. It's very difficult to plan if you don't know how much money you're going to get in the next year. This biennium, we are requesting the General Assembly to increase the Home and Community Care Block Grant by funding $7 million more and in recurring funds. This will allow us to meet at least some of the needs of the folks on the waiting list and also to plan better when we know what funding will be coming. Our second priority is to maintain and increase funding for senior centers by adding $350,000 in recurring funds to the current senior center general purpose funding. You're going to hear that word recurring a few times because that's a problem in a number of areas. Our own Kernodle Center, Senior Center, is a center of excellence. I was privileged to learn firsthand last spring about the grueling process and high standards that the center staff met to achieve that distinction. The senior Tar Heel delegate is appointed to the group of examiners who review the requirements for earning that designation. And that was my first time to experience that. It occurs every 5 years. Might be interesting for some of you folks to get on that commission that comes in and makes those reviews and decisions. The leadership at the Senior Center works very hard to provide the level of programming and accountability that's required to achieve the designation of a center of excellence. The number of people to serve is climbing, as are their costs for administration, provision of services, and programs to meet their needs. Our third priority is to increase funding for Project CARE, which stands for Caregivers Running on Empty. This special program is designed and tested in North Carolina and is the only program that is specifically aimed at supporting unpaid family caregivers caring for someone with Alzheimer's or a related dementia. The program was limited to a few areas in North Carolina until the senior Tar Heel legislature made it a priority to expand it statewide and increase the funding for it over the last two biennials. This is one of several successful legislative initiatives from the senior Tar Heel legislature over the last 4 years, I'm proud to say. Even with those increases, the number of families served averaged only 7 per county. Pretty pathetic. When the current estimate of people in North Carolina with Alzheimer's dementia is 160,000. And 459,000 unpaid caregivers are providing their care. That doesn't go very far. The number of people living with Alzheimer's dementia is expected to increase by 31% by 2025. That's 6 years from now. In order to help family caregivers to care for their loved ones at home, Project CARE provides needs assessments, care management, and respite vouchers. Families that are selected for the program are able to access up to 3 vouchers of $500 each per year. And that's as long as there's money to meet that need. It, again, doesn't go very far with 7 families per county. The alternative for folks who currently are providing their loved ones care at home is residential or institutional care, which I'm sure you know is substantially more costly, both to the family and to the public funds that subsidize the cost of care. We're requesting the General Assembly to increase Project CARE funding by $500,000 this biennium per year, and by 10% annually thereafter. It will not keep up with the growth, but it will serve more people than we currently are able to serve. Priority number 4 is to strengthen and fund North Carolina's Adult Protective Services program. Protective services are required by law to be provided by county departments of social services to adults of age 18 and over who are abused, neglected, and exploited. Almost 3/4 of those receiving adult protective services were adults over 60. The state of North Carolina has not provided any funding since the 2010-2012 state budget. Services are funded by county governments and a decreasing federal social services block grant. The senior Tar Heel legislature is recommending a comprehensive evaluation and review of adult protective services in North Carolina and to make available $7 million in recurring funds to meet the growing needs. Unfortunately, as our population increases, so do the protective service complaints and reports, and that needs to be addressed. And since you're having to fund it, I'm sure you'd like to see the extra help from the state. Priority 5 is to set standards for staff to patient ratios in nursing homes. The senior Tar Heel legislature recommends that the General Assembly enact legislation which establishes either a mandatory standardized hours per patient daily or a minimum staff-to-patient ratio for direct patient care, including enforcement standards and consequences to ensure quality care in nursing homes in the state of North Carolina, regardless of whether they are a for-profit or a nonprofit organization. We know this is an uphill battle. Nursing homes have a very strong lobby that will fight this kind of thing, but the the facts are what they are. The level of staffing by nursing staff, which includes not only registered nurses and LPNs, but also certified nursing assistants, is directly correlated to the quality of care that is received. There are studies and statistics to bear this out. Unfortunately, the Federal Nursing Home Reform Act, which was part of the Omnibus Budget Reconciliation Act, I'm tripping over my tongue, of 1987, requires minimum staffing levels for registered nurses, licensed practical nurses, and a minimum educational training for certified nurses' aides, but fails to establish a specific requirement for minimum caregiver-resident ratio or a minimum standard for the number of hours per patient day that a resident should be receiving care. Certified nursing aides, also known as CNAs, are responsible for performing routine tasks and providing hands-on patient care in nursing homes. They are the ones who really do the brunt of the care and the work. Under the supervision of nursing and medical staff, CNAs answer patient calls, serve meals, make beds, help patients eat, dress, bathe, provide skin care, take vital signs, help patients walk and get in and out of bed. In a nursing home, the quality of care each resident receives is largely dependent upon the one-to-one care that those CNAs provide. The health and safety of residents are compromised when the facility is understaffed. Residents are at a higher risk of receiving poor care and being victims of abuse when the staff is unable to respond adequately to patient needs. So that is our case for requiring a study to set standards and to add to what already exists. If you are looking at the back page of the fact sheet, it tells you what the current nursing requirements are, which sometimes are one nurse on a floor of a multi-story building, one nurse at night. And usually that's not an RN in all cases. And in some cases, the head nurse for the facility is the only RN in the facility. And that is meeting minimum requirements. And a lot of homes only look at minimum requirements. They do only what they absolutely have to do. So it's important to let them know what they have to do by establishing these ratios. We had another priority that tied with this one for our fifth, and it got voted down, but it had to do with transportation. And maybe next year we'll get that one on the next biennium, we'll get that one on the list of priorities. But in order for people to get to medical care, to get to the other essential services, we have a very, as you'll find in this book, a very high number of folks who have no access to transportation. We have a significant portion of our county that's considered rural. And in those cases, our transportation services are especially essential in order for folks to get what they need when they need it. So I appreciate your giving me time to bring you this updated information and to report on the work of our senior Tar Heel legislature and for your support. And I hope that you'll join me and the other delegates and alternates in advocating for our priorities with our representatives Ross and Riddell and Senator Gunn. Gail and I will be in Raleigh next week meeting with them, and we have high hopes for our concerns and proposals being considered seriously. Thank you for your time and support.
Thank you. A lot of information.
Does anybody have any questions?
I wanted to ask her, before you go, what type of vacancy or available beds do we have in the county for assisted living or nursing home and so forth?
I don't have that information with me. I could get it for you.
Yeah, I'd like to, because we were tight there for a long time. Mm-hmm. And I know when, you know, I like to share this with you. If you've never been through it, you don't know what it's like. Mm-hmm. My mom and dad moved up from South Carolina when dad got sick, and he was in a wheelchair. And he and mother, they were going to go to Twin Lakes, but they stayed somewhere else. And my wife would go over and fix their meals and do the shopping for them. And then when dad died, my mom moved in with me. That's the only way I would have had it, She couldn't. No, I loved her dearly, but she couldn't have gotten a glass of water. And she had dementia, early stages of it, and it just got worse. And she stayed with me for 10 years. And most people don't realize it, but she was there for 10, and during that time, my wife had breast cancer. We were pulled as hard as we could be pulled, but we loved it. It was a care of love. And I would come in at night, and Susan would come home from work, and we would have to get Mama ready for bed. We had to feed her. She quit eating. And when we'd get her in bed, we'd have to make sure there was enough pillows on one side, you know, so she wouldn't roll off in the floor. And then finally people say, look, you and Susan have done all you can do. It was tough. But at that time, we were told, you know, there was only like two places she could go and only just a handful of beds that were available. And I went into a place where one of the options that we had, and I went in, I went in the back, and I came down the hall and couldn't help but glance at some of the rooms. And I couldn't even get out of the building. And I went in the bathroom to start crying. Because it was just going to be tough to let Mom go. And they said, you know, the people that she went with, I won't mention any names. Oh, we'll fail. I said, she won't eat. You've literally got to coax her to do everything. Drink, eat, so forth and so on. I even changed jobs so I could go home and take her, fix her lunch, and give it to her. And then sometimes really had to push her hard to eat. But, she'll eat. We'll make her eat. And I'd go up there and tray of food just sitting there. And there had not been much effort at all, if any, to get her to eat. And she died not long after she got there. And, you know, it's tough. It really is. And I kid people about getting a little older. I say, you know, when you get old, a little older, you can pretend like you're getting a little slower. And you can pretend like you're not as sharp. And then you realize you're not pretending. And but we need all the attention we can put on this. I don't think America has addressed as well as they should how to take care of the elderly. I think some countries revere the elderly, and I'm not quite sure that we're at that point, or should, or we could be at a greater point. But
we have to stand up for ourselves to some degree.
No.
But I'm not sure how many years ago this situation with your mother occurred, but I wear several hats with my volunteering, and one of them is with the Community Advisory Committee and visiting licensed homes. And there's another list in this book that tells you how many homes of various kinds that we have in this county. And there are 8 nursing homes. We have close to 50 adult care homes, which are essentially assisted living, and then quite a number, over I think maybe 200 and some, of family care homes. And our committee visits those homes to advocate for resident rights. Some of the homes have a small number of people, and some of them specialize in people with mental illness. Some of them have a mixture of ages and medical or disability problems. The assisted living homes more and more are providing special areas and services aimed at their dementia population. And some of them are quite nice. There are a couple of new ones, and there are some that have been here for a while that I'm very pleased to know the quality of care that they give. Whether it's enough, well, there you get into the cost. The nicer ones are more costly because many of them are private pay. And the ones that are able to take Medicaid generally have a lower standard because they don't have as much money coming in. So we have our challenges in our county and our state and nationwide for sure.
Adrian, you may be able to get back with me on the bed availability.
And I wrote that down.
Space availability, because I think the counties are allotted space or allotted numbers from the state.
That's right.
Number of beds. Assistance.
And I'd like to know where we stand.
Okay. You mentioned Twin Lakes. I live at Twin Lakes.
Do you?
And I'm blessed to be able to do that. There are a lot of people that would not be able to have that choice. But Twin Lakes is tearing down its health center, but it will be replaced with a state-of-the-art health center that has the exact same number of beds. So it will not expand its availability any, it will just be better. And that's part of that system that we're up against, is having enough beds. But again, when we look at trying to support people at home, I don't know whether you were able to take advantage of any of the in-home care services, but the Older Americans Act was amended in 2000 to mandate the Family Caregiver Program nationwide, and it was funded immediately, which was kind of an amazing thing. And I was a case manager, program manager in that area agency of aging in Georgia for 10 years. We did a lot with that. We didn't perhaps do enough because we used what money we had, but we did a lot with what we had. And that's happening all over the country. Those funds provide respite and in-home care and the case management services. But they provide it to people with all kinds of circumstances and illnesses and disabilities, whereas the Project CARE program is specifically for dementia. But we do have services available that we need people to be aware that they can access, and that sometimes is hard to get across.
Well, that's why we're so glad that you could come today to help us raise awareness about the needs of the elderly in our community. You know, in my law practice in Castle County, I often contact issues relating to the elderly that I think they're certainly not unique to Castle. They're here too. One thing you mentioned, the Adult Protective Services program, that they look into situations of neglect. And that can be a real problem because you have a senior citizen who's, you know, doing great, living at home, and then just gradually over time their abilities decline, and maybe they don't have a family member close by. Other people respect their dignity or respect their privacy. You know, you don't want to sound like you're criticizing or getting involved in somebody else's business, but at the same time, maybe they need somebody to ask, and it just can, over time, sort of morph into a situation of neglect that's
Absolutely.
Not intentional on anybody's part. It's just, and it's sad to see how that can happen. And then I think you touched on this a little bit, the gap between people who qualify for Medicaid and then people who can afford to pay for nursing home care. You know, there are people who really, really need nursing home care and they have too much money to qualify for Medicaid, but they don't have the finances or the resources pay for it themselves, and so they kind of languish in this, really it's kind of a hell that they end up in where they're miserable.
A lot of those
terrible.
Are on our waiting list, because that's the people that are lower income, not eligible for Medicaid, are targeted for services, prioritized for services, but they have to know about them and ask about them in order to get them. And then we have to have the funding to not put them on a waiting list, but to meet those needs.
Does anybody else have any comments?
I just want to thank Foxy and Gail for your advocacy. I know Miss Willie May Kern come up here many years, and
oh, yes.
She had a little longer speech. I'm sorry, Foxy, she had.
I don't pretend to be able to walk in her shoes. She was remarkable.
You thank
you
all
good
for,
job.
Thank you for doing
you
that.
You have done a good
thank
job.
Thank you.
Yeah, you took the words out of my mouth. I was going to thank Foxy and Gail for all that you all do. in advocating for the elderly. That y'all are very, very passionate and very knowledgeable, and people really don't have any idea about your personal commitment or the sacrifices you make with your time and your resources to try to help this segment of our community, and we just really appreciate that.
Thank you.
Well, I've been fortunate enough to be serving on your committee, and a lot of good information you provide. Beg your pardon?
One of them.
One of them.
One of them, right. Just one of
them. The planning committee.
But
that's a good committee.
I can't remember if it was in y'all's meeting or in another meeting, I heard that if you're between the age of 50 and 85 today and in relatively good health, the probabilities are you'll live to be over 100, possibly 105 to 110 years of age. I think about that relative to the people in Alamance County who are in their 60s, 70s, retiring right now. Are you prepared financially to live to be 105 or 110? And that changes the whole dynamic for a lot of people when they look at what they plan for from a retirement perspective, and especially when you look at the interest rates that we're able to get on retirement funds right now. So
it also has an impact on the state looking at Medicare expansion, right. Medicaid expansion, and what that will mean. Can they afford Medicaid expansion when they've got longer lifespans of folks who are already on it?
Exactly.
And increasing numbers. It's a real delicate balance for sure.
That's a great point I had not heard before.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Foxy.
All right, is our tax administrator handy? Is he in the overflow room?
He's back in the overflow.
Here he comes.
He's out collecting them.
Yeah, he's out collecting taxes. Brush the dust off his plate. We're ready to go.
Good morning. How are you doing this morning?
Great. Good. How are you?
How about you?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me here to talk about taxes. I know it's everybody's most exciting topic. And today we get to do a very exciting thing. I'm asking the board to authorize me to go forward with advertising delinquent taxes on real property. It's something we do every year, and it applies to anyone that has a real property parcel with unpaid taxes. Now, as of January 31st, we had about 4.8 million in unpaid real property taxes. As of the close of business at the end of February, we had 2.9. So you can see it's coming in pretty rapidly. And we try as much as possible, if somebody makes the payment up to the moment we run the file for the newspaper, their name does not appear. But we can't guarantee past February 28th because you get late postmarks coming in through the mail. So we're kind of transitioning from paying to stay out to already being in the paper. We split our advertisements between the Alamance News and the Times News. It's about a 40-60 split. Last year we advertised about 4,000 individuals, and so we would anticipate something very similar this year. It's my recommendation we apply a $5 fee. So the good news with advertisement is that the tax-paying citizen does not pick up the bill for the non-paying citizen. That person pays their own advertisement, and $5 would be a pretty good approximation of that. And additionally, I would recommend around March 21st is a good date of advertisement. And so we'd have just a little bit more time, and we'll run that file and get it done. Any questions regarding the advertisement?
Have we had that $5 fee on in the past?
Mm-hmm.
I thought
yep.
we had.
Yep.
So that's not a nothing new there.
No, nothing new. It's been there for quite some time. And you can set whatever fee that you'd like to set.
Right.
On the safe side, $5. We could almost go to a $4 fee, but we might scrape into, again, the timely citizen picking up some portion of the late citizen's bill. So just for safety, the $5 to make sure we're covered.
What is our percentage rate of collections? What are we running?
Right, so right now we're at 97.09%. Our goal this year is to break the 99% mark. We were very close last year. And we are ahead of last year, but it's kind of like you watch the Olympics. If somebody wins by a tenth of a second, they say they shattered the record.
Right.
We work in very small increments now. So we're a little ahead of last year, and we'll celebrate if we're a little ahead at the close.
You've done a good job with that.
Yes, he has. All right, so we'd be seeking a motion to advertise our delinquent real property taxes
so moved.
At a rate of $5 a parcel. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed?
I didn't say anything. Aye.
I don't think I did either. I count as an aye.
You know, Jeremy, you need to look up the word tax.
Uh-oh.
Look at his origin, mm-hmm. and what the words meant and so forth. In the Greek, it meant to fix. I'm not sure we qualify. In Latin, to censor. Charge was in there, compute, so maybe it was more of an acceptable Latin. French, taxer, or so forth, so on. But might be another word we ought to use for tax.
I've long thought that I need to change my title to revenue director.
Yeah.
Because revenue is just not quite as aggressive
or collector, yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
The tax collectors were not famous in the Bible.
No, I hear that on many Sundays. They look at me when they start talking about publicans and sinners.
Well, at least you're there.
Right. Thank you for it.
Thank you so much. Mr.
Haygood,
all you.
Well, good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'll give you a copy of what I'm going to go over this morning. Get started.
Thank you.
A very distilled version of the finance plan, as well as a hard copy of the PowerPoint slides that I'm going to go through. I do have copies for the press.
I just want to take a moment and tell you that, as you well know, we've been working pretty hard for the past year to get information together for the board to consider, for the public to consume, about the costs of the bond projects that have been proposed by Alamance Burlington School System and Alamance Community College. We've done a lot of work to change how we budget and put all this information together in a capital plan. And we have some folks here with us this morning that I appreciate coming. We've been working very closely with Dr. Benson and Jeremy Teeter and Todd Thorpe from the school system to get this information together, as well as Dr. Gatewood and his folks, Cindy Colley and Tom Hartman. We really appreciate their help. And we also have Ted from Davenport is with us here today, and they have been critical to help us understand how do you plan for almost $190 million worth of debt and keep it in context with our responsibilities to make sure there's funding for county school system and community college for even non-bond debt. So I'm going to go through a PowerPoint presentation and talk to you about where we are right now today, what I believe we have come to after all of this work. There's no action required by the board today. This is to give this to you to be thinking about. If there's going to be action, it's going to take place as part of the budget, right? So this will be for you to talk, think about, ask questions of me or the school system or community college staff that are here today. So I'll go ahead and get started. As I go through this, please don't hesitate to stop me if you have questions for me or for any of our team that's worked on all this. So when the bonds for ACC and ABSS were beginning to be discussed, and once they started to gain traction, from the county staff perspective, we knew we had to change the way we do business. We really had to put a lot of emphasis on capital planning, and that's what we've done. And again, that one part of the handout that I've given you is a very distilled version of the overall capital plan. We've separated capital from our operations. In the past, we thought about that all together. So if we saw advantages in the capital side of the house, debt stepped down, debt paid off, we would oftentimes swing that over to operations. We're no longer doing that. We're proposing to no longer do that. We've put all the projects and the funding amounts and funding sources together in this plan for all capital that the county's responsible for. The county's responsible for county government, obviously, as well as the capital for the school system and the community college. And the plan that we've worked up establishes timelines for debt. That's current debt. We have some debt that we owe right now, also for this proposed debt for the bond projects. Also to plan for how much we give ourselves, the schools, and the community college each year for capital funding that's not involving the bond projects. And we have to use this plan process to think about future debt. We know that down the road, Alamance County will continue to grow, and this is probably not the last bond project we will see. In time, there will be other bond projects. We think this planning effort has laid the groundwork for how that might work in the future. We also wanted to use this planning process to show the taxpaying public, all the elected officials that are involved, which includes you, of course, the Board of Education, our appointed folks on the Board of Trustees with the Community College, as well as the lenders that we would be talking to when we go for bonds, that the county does have a plan. We do recognize our responsibilities and the current scope of them. So I'm going to talk a little bit about each of the three entities that are involved in this capital plan. I'm going to start off with Alamance County Government. Our capital responsibilities include county buildings, like the county office building or environmental health and human service, as well as the criminal justice system, which is our courts and our jails, our probation and parole offices, those kind of things. So what we've come up with in our long-range plan is there's no property tax increase needed for the county to address its facility needs. So we're looking at all of the county's CIP needs, and we're proposing to not raise taxes or not. We're not looking at a proposed tax increase for the county. This is very similar to what we've talked about from the past year. We would make use of our own debt. We have debt that we owe for county government projects in the past. We're paying that down. As we pay that down, we're proposing to leave those dollars froze in the capital plan for future county capital needs. We also have our own capital reserves that we've built up over time from the sale of various properties. And we fund ourselves $250,000 every year for county government capital, and we're proposing to freeze the county share at that. So the county's piece of this capital plan that you've got in front of you provides $250,000 a year for CIP projects. We're looking at planning on a 7-year period, and you'll see this as a common theme for the school system and the community college. We're looking at a 7-year planning period. This is for non-bond projects, right? The bonds for ACC and the school system, they don't cover all the needs. So we're going to try to work together in tandem to come up with a 7-year plan for the non-bond project. Our county facility plan is almost complete. I'll be bringing you that information either at your next meeting or possibly April 1. It'll be one of those two dates that I'll bring you what we're seeing from a county facility standpoint. But what we do have in the county plan, laying groundwork for the facility plan, is without having to raise any taxes, if we freeze all the amounts that we've got going to county capital, we believe in year 2020 we could borrow $5 million to do work to county properties, which is very important. We have a lot of deferred maintenance. And without tax increases, if we freeze all these dollar amounts as we're talking about doing, in between the years 2022 and 2025, we would be able to borrow another $15 million of installment debt to implement some of the things you're going to see in this county facility plan. So those are not bonds. Those installment loans do not require any kind of vote. Those dollar amounts can be done simply by the approval of the board. So just a brief overview of county government, how it fits into its own capital plan. We've made a conscious effort. Our needs are a little smaller and not quite as well known as the school system and the community college, but they are equally important. So we'll talk a little bit about the community college's piece of the capital plan. So we've worked very closely with the community college, and what I'm going to be talking to you about, particularly the proposed tax increase, would provide enough funding for all Alamance Community College bond projects to be done. All of their projects that they have proposed would be done, and they would all be done on the timelines that the community college has said will work for their needs. So in order to keep the property tax rate down for the community college capital plan, we're freezing their debt step down. They have debt too that we're currently paying. So we're saying as we pay their debt down, we're going to leave those dollars in the capital plan. We're not going to take them over into any operating funds. We're using the community college has a very small amount of capital reserves. We are putting those into the plan. We're freezing our current funding for the plan at 18-19 levels. So there's county dollars that are going to the community college now for their CIP. We're saying we're gonna cap it at that and continue to put those dollars into the plan. And of course, there would be a need for new property tax revenue. For the community college's piece of the capital plan, which includes all of their bond projects as well as funding for non-bond needs every year, property tax increase of 1.4 cents would be needed in the upcoming year. So besides the bond projects, the 1.4 cent property tax increase plus all those other funding sources that I mentioned provide the college with CIP non-bond project monies every year for the next 7 years, and you can see how it's laid out for the college. These are based on the dollar amounts that the community college indicated to us that they would need every year. So those funds are in the plan to be given to the college. This is for work to be done besides the bond project. The community college would not begin to build capital reserves in our plan until fiscal year 25-26. That means all the money going into the plan from the tax increase, the money that we're already spending, it would be used to pay debt on all of the college debt as well as the education bonds. So they wouldn't start seeing any room to spend more money on non-bond projects until 25-26. But those capital reserves do begin to build in 25-26. And if all things being equal, the college could use those for future debt. They could put more money toward their annual CIP projects, or if they had an emergency, they would be able to do that too. Big takeaway from the community college is all bond projects would be able to be done on the timelines that they have given us, and the tax increase that would need to happen is 1.4 cents, property tax increase. Let's talk just a moment about the school system. So again, with the school system, the financial plan that we've put together, all the proposed education bond projects that the school system has put forward are included. So we've included every project that the schools have brought to our attention, and they're also on the approved timelines. So we've worked very closely with Dr. Benson and his team to put together how, when would construction start, when would construction end, when would the debt need to be issued. The property tax increase that you're going to see on this slide would allow for all those things to happen. We also use, in the school system's piece of our capital plan, ABSS debt step down. They have current debt too, right now in place. And again, we'll do the same thing. As we pay down their debt, we leave the dollars that we're paying in the plan. We're not taking, you know, if we pay down some of their debt, we don't reallocate that over to operating. We leave it in the capital plan. The school system has access to capital reserve. Those are mostly lottery funds that have built up in reserve or school sales tax funds that have built up in reserves. We're planning to use North Carolina lottery funds to help pay for school capital, as well as new school sales tax funds and new property tax revenue. So for the school system, the property tax increase that would be needed to keep all the projects in line and on time would be 5.64 cents increase in fiscal year 19-20. So that 5.64 property tax increase provides for all the bond projects on their timelines. It also provides the school system with $3.3 million annually for their CIP projects. This is what the school system has been talking about recently. They were interested in seeing how our capital plan could provide them with this dollar amount. They have capital needs beyond the bond projects, and $3.3 million would be available to them every year to spend for non-bond projects. Again, as with the community college and the county itself, we would be working with the school system on a seven-year project time period to determine what that $3.3 million would be spent on. Up until fiscal year 25-26, the school system, much like the community college, they do not begin to build capital reserves in our plan beyond the cost of debt and the CIP funding until 25-26. And same thing with the school system. Any capital reserve funds that they would begin to build after fiscal year 25-26 could be used for emergencies or possibly future debt, or be used to give more money annually toward the $3.3 million project. So this is a very distilled version of what has taken a long time to put together. Bottom line is, for us to be able to fund this proposed capital plan that includes county capital, community college capital, school system capital, primarily the major pieces of this plan are the education bond projects, all the education bond projects on the timelines expressed by the school system and the community college. The total property tax rate impact in fiscal year 19-20 would be 7.04 cents. If you'll remember, when we were looking at this last year before the vote, we told the boards and the public that we thought it, the highest would be 7.88 cents. So there has been some change in that property tax rate impact. That can be attributed to two factors. One, we changed the timelines for many of these projects. So as the timelines change, it requires less property tax. And the school system's request for additional CIP money brings it up a little bit too. So it's not obviously not quite a wash. We're still less than what we originally thought at 7.04 cents. If we structured this debt, you'll remember back last year when we were talking about how to put the debt together. If we structured the debt, we project that it could require a 6.29 cent property tax increase. There are some concerns about structuring the debt. If you'll recall, it requires additional interest It also pushes the principal payments out till later into the debt, which can hurt, it could hinder us if we wanted to borrow more money later on. There were some concerns from the local government commission about using structured debt, but it is an option that is available. And it's important for the board to also know that a natural property tax impact would be 11.04 cents to fund this plan the way that we're talking about. And natural means you raise the property taxes as you issue the debt. So 7.04 cents is one time upfront. The board would raise property taxes once, and then we would put those revenues into the plan as they created money. If the board said we wanted to wait and only raise taxes as the debt is issued, which I think we're talking about five debt issuances for this overall plan, it would total up to 11.04 cents. So obviously, the lesser property tax rate impact, if you're going to do all of the projects, is 7.04 cents one time up front. So some things to think about in this plan that we're talking about. We have figured sales tax revenues conservatively. All right, we have revenues that we get from Article 40 and 42. These are sales tax revenues that the state requires that we spend on school system capital. We're using 15-16 numbers. I'll tell you that I feel comfortable with those numbers. We're bringing in more sales tax than that now, but this is a volatile source of revenue for us. And for this dollar amount of debt, $189.6 million, we want to be sure that we've got enough revenue to cover that debt payment. Once we commit to debt, we have to make the payment. So we're projecting to use school sales tax revenue, but we are figuring it conservatively, as we are with the North Carolina lottery revenues. We're figuring those conservatively too. They are based on annualized first quarter 17-18 figures. The lottery is another very volatile source of funding. It's up and down. Yes.
If we go into a recession, and probably the first of next year, maybe, what's that going to do to the sales tax?
It would go down.
So what's that going to do to the money that we have available at that time?
I think the way we're figuring this, we're figuring in the plan adding $6.7 million in sales tax into this plan to help pay for this debt. That's data that's fiscal year 15-16 old, so we're bringing in more now. I think if we did have a recession, because we're being so conservative with these revenues, we would still be okay. That would be my caution.
That's what I wanted to know. Yeah. I agree with you. Okay. I'm okay with that.
Yes, thank you. And another funding source to consider, to think about, is, you know, we just put the Article 46 sales tax referendum on the ballot. It was defeated by the voters, but it would create $4.8 million worth of revenue annually. That is equal to 3.62 cents. So that could be considered again. I think we've talked about, it has to be a countywide vote, so it would be the in year 2020. But the board could decide to put that back on the referendum and dedicate all or some portion of those revenues, if it passed, to help offset this plan's costs. And we also have the North Carolina school capital bonds. I just read that I think two versions of school capital bonds have been reintroduced in Raleigh. When that was originally talked about, I believe it was a year ago, maybe more, in the model that was being bandied about at that time, the county stood, in one of the models at least, to gain about $24 million. I put that up there just as a point of reference. I'm not sure how we would benefit from the two plans that are being put out there now, but it would suffice it to say we would be able to figure on funding to come and possibly help offset some of these costs too. But so take away from this, we have figured conservatively. Yes, sir.
How would that $24 million coming to Alamance County, how would that be allocated on the bonds?
So
ABSS bond, or would it split between ACC and ABSS?
So I think the original $24 million was strictly for the public education system. I'm not familiar with how the two new models that are being proposed, if we receive money, some would be available for the community college system. I think whatever the particulars that wind up passing and actually happening, we would apply them to both of these sets of debt. So, you know, the debt's being issued over five issuances, so if something happens in the next year about school capital bonds, there would still be time to apply it to some of these other projects that we have. So again, the main thing to take away is we are figuring conservative on the revenue streams that are not property tax related. That's your sales tax. But I I understand Mr. Lashley's concerns. You know, we're hearing some talk in the private world about the possibility of, you know, either at least a plateau, if not some slowdown.
Right.
We want to be ready for that if we're going to issue debt. So besides the funding, besides the money, that's a huge piece of this, and it's obviously going to make it possible to do all these capital projects. But really, for the projects to succeed, and for this new commitment to our capital responsibilities to succeed, I think there are a few other things besides just the money that are very important. We, as county government, we have to be dedicated to this capital planning and project monitoring model. We have set ourselves up in the county manager's office and in the finance department, and are working to do even more, put ourselves in a position to stay on top of our capital responsibilities and these projects, particularly these bond projects, to be able to work closely and effectively with school system and community college staff to make sure the money flows timely in the way that it's supposed to. We've talked with the community college and the school system staff and have basically already formed this technical review committee that consists of us folks from the county, as well as Dr. Benson and Dr. Gatewood and their staff, and we meet regularly and we'll continue to meet regularly to plan for our non-bond projects, as well as talk about how the bond projects are going for both groups. I do think that you will soon see me coming to you with a recommendation for you to approve a board oversight function, where what we've talked about with the school system is possibly two commissioners being assigned, along with two Board of Education members being assigned, where the TRC would meet regularly with that group and say, here's the plan, here's what we've come up with, here's how the projects are going, and then that would come to this board too. But at least there would be almost like the Joint Facilities Group, except instead of going out looking at schools, you'd now be focused on the projects, how are they going, what's the status. I also believe that it will be critical for the school system and the community college to hire project managers. I believe both groups are in the process of doing that now, either as hired employees or as contract services. That's going to be critical to make sure these projects go the way that they're supposed to happen. And we've worked with all three groups to create a capital plan that will take this financial piece, the piece that we went over, if you remember back at the joint meeting with the Board of Education, where we laid out all the projects with all its details, and the non-bond projects, and put them all into one place. I think we've looked at several that have been done around the state. I think Chatham County is one of the models that we've looked at that we'll be bringing to you that puts all this data in one place. So as you think about the possibility of 7.04 cents property tax increase to help make this capital finance plan possible, it's important that the board also remember we are in budget times. Right? We have a county operating budget. We haven't forgotten it. It's still there. It's still it has a lot of needs. What I'm hearing from department heads is we are going to have some personnel and operating need increases in our operating budget this year. I have some concerns about the way we've been budgeting fund balance for the past several years. I'd love to see that be able to be reduced somewhat. I don't like the idea of budgeting as much of our savings as we do to make ends meet, but I'll be working on that, as well as we'll need to bear in mind that eventually, in the next couple of years, we'll be having to fund new operating costs for the school system and community college facilities that come out of these plans, particularly the new high school. That's the largest piece, I think, estimated at about $1.5 million in new county dollars that had to be spent to do that. So as I said, there's no action needed by the board today. I wanted to bring this information to you, give you a chance to ask questions of all of us that are here, as well as give you some time to think about it as we get into the budget season. Some important dates that are on the way. ACC and ABSS, we're asking them to be present on April 1st to present their budget information to the Board of Commissioners. Then the retreat on the April 15th will be primarily county departments and myself giving you information about what we see in total. The manager's recommended budget will be put to the board on May 6th, and then the budget public hearing will be on May the 20th. And I believe that is all. So if you have questions, now is a great time to ask while we have all of us here, and we will certainly try to answer.
I'd like to ask, you talked about there was consideration for the sales tax increase to be factored in here. Was there consideration at all of what the property tax would increase over the term of the debt service. I mean, our county has grown, I would say historically, an average of at least 3% a year over the time I've been on this board now. Would you differ with that?
I think past two budgets that I've worked on, we've seen about 2% increase. Is that right, Susan, in our property tax values? We have figured a 1% increase annually into this plan. So the 7.04 cent property tax increase you see includes the base growing every year throughout the time of the debt.
And you're saying 1%. The base average has only been 2%?
I think that's roughly correct. But the plan has incorporated 1%. So,
that's a good cushion. Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Well, it's all of these figures have been conservative. It does mean a higher property tax rate impact to fund the plan. However, again, once we commit to the debt, once you issue that debt, you have to make that debt payment no matter what happens to the economy or anything else. So we've tried to be conservative about it.
It looks like last year, and with it being a revalue year, factoring in the appeals, Jeremy had estimated a 2.28%.
Okay. So it's pushing 3. That's what I thought. Let me ask you this, hypothetically. I voted to put the bonds on the ballot, no doubt about that. I support the new high school. But I'm not ashamed to tell you, I've never been in favor of the total amount. If we had no monies to fall back on, like money you're holding in reserve, you know, monies that was going to debt service that would have zeroed out eventually, if we just financed $189 million, cold turkey, in other words, nothing behind us held in the drawer, how much would it have taken to finance that debt from zero to, with nothing to fall back on? Like, so, yeah.
So we asked Davenport to run those numbers for us. So if you took just the education bond debt, $189.6 million, new debt service, didn't factor in any debt step down,
right,
any of the plan items, the total tax increase would be 9.11 cents up
there. Really? Yeah. Okay, so it's lower than I thought.
So you remember when we first started talking about the bonds, we estimated if you borrowed every dime of it up front one time and had to raise a property tax to do that, it was going to be like 12.19 cents. That was every dime borrowed up front. What happens is we now know the timing of the projects. We know that we would not do that. The timing of the projects alone brings it down to about 9.1 cents. So. What helps bring it from 9.1 to 7.04 is factoring in all of this debt step down and these other
putting those back into it.
Yes, yes. And what we've done in the past is if we pay debt, the debt payment gets lower, we take it over into operating. Right? We say there's a margin there that we can use over here in operating. We're not doing that anymore in an attempt to keep this property tax rate low. It does mean we don't have that ability in our operating side. To say, well, thank goodness we paid down debt a little bit. We now have a little more money to spend in operating. But you know, again, I think the county committing to funding as best it can these different capital responsibilities that we have, especially in the face of this large amount of debt, you know, that's the way to go.
I like that plan. I like the idea of segregating the capital budget. It's much more business-like. Solid way to plan it.
I think it would help also in the future as we, one of the best things I think that has come out of this planning process is we have a great working relationship with the school system and the community college. I think as they continue to work on their capital, because there are always going to be more capital needs, we now have a model that we can use to have a discussion about it and really know what we're talking about and what the costs could be. So.
I'd like to say one more thing. So I'm not going to be up here 2 years from now. But I would hope that, I mean, first of all, let me say I like the structure. I've told you in the beginning, 6 cents is about all I'm willing to pay for. For the total package. But I would hope that county management and the future boards would realize we're like a family. You know, family likes to do a lot of things. Family likes to go on vacations. They like new cars. They like new houses, new furniture. But there's a point to where you say, this is all we're going to do. Somebody's managing the purse strings at home, and they're going to say, we're managing purse strings here. This is all we're going to do. Take it or leave it. Do what you got to do to meet that line. And I'm not sure we had that philosophy going into this. You sit back as a county manager, you sit back as a board, and you sit, you say, okay, our county's valued at, the valuation is what? What is it, 10 million, 10 billion?
About 14 billion.
Oh, is it 10 million now? Lord, shows you how far I'm behind. Well, it was 10 prior to the, okay, that's what I'm thinking. That's what I'm thinking about. But you're sitting back saying, okay, we got a $14 billion county that we can get revenues off of. And we got sales tax coming in of this amount, fees coming in of this amount. You put it all together. I don't think it's unreasonable to think our tax rate shouldn't be but so much. Now, some people, including people that was on this board before the election, believe that tax rates, the numerical value of the of what it was, whether it be 85, 42, or whatever, was irrelevant. I couldn't disagree more. But I think there comes a point to where county management and future boards need to sit back and say, this is all we're going to do. This is all we're going to put on our citizens, plus or minus, pro or con. And I do believe we didn't do that here, and I don't believe we're doing it now. But I do like the structure, Dad. I will say that.
Well, the people that it's relevant to are the people that have to pay the taxes.
Exactly right.
Well, and that's been the...
You've got to keep in mind the people that have to pay the taxes.
That's been the balance to strike here, I think, from my perspective, is to try to say, what rate can I show you that funds all the projects that have been proposed by both groups and keeps the tax rate as low as possible? I think that's what you have here in front of you, 7.04 cents. It does give them each group the projects that they've requested as well as the funding that they've requested for their non-bond project. So it's at this point, I think if we're there are ways to reduce that property tax rate, but it would mean having to think about either not doing all projects or reducing dollar amounts that they get annually. This is as good as it gets for doing everything that's been proposed at the lowest rate possible.
I've had a thought about this, and I know we are on an 8-year tax rebound. How would it look if we did a 4-year, which we have that option as a county of doing, because as I ride up and down the interstate, I see a lot of new real estate. Now, I know you're taking it in, but I also know there is a large demand for property in Alamance County.
Yep.
And with a large demand for property, values increase. How many people do we have object to our last rebound, Jeremy?
Not many. It was quite a home showing. It was very very even. We tried to be thorough and make sure to weed out as much problems on the front end to avoid them on the back end.
And you did a great job. I commend you on that. But then again, I'm thinking, okay, did we get it quite where it should have been?
Well,
and it's a fine balance.
And I will say one of the challenges, if we're talking about year-to-year property tax growth compared to year market growth, is we can only capture at historic rate.
Right.
And so part of what you see if you look at the open market is inflation of value. We can't touch that unless we have a revamp.
Right.
We're just getting new added capital. So with a shorter cycle, you would see that brought in more
frequently. I mean, dealing with the real estate and stuff, it changes. I know from day to day, you know, and you talk 8 years, things definitely change. And I don't know if that's something the board would have an interest even looking at, but to reevaluate every 4 years. I know it costs you to do it, but what are the values of it?
Absolutely.
Just a thought.
Well, is that something the board would like to get more information about in the next, I don't know if we want to do that before or after the budget? The budget takes a lot of time.
It takes a lot of time.
Well, Jeremy and I talked a little bit about how that might look, and so it could be that as we, maybe at the retreat, we'd be able to talk to you a little bit about how, what the cost might be, how it might look, what the advantages are. I don't know if that's, I mean, that's coming up in April, but that's a little ways down the road.
I think in the past, my experiences, is it cost so, it's, the cost is so high to revale. I think it just wouldn't pay to do it for every 4 years.
Well,
that's what we decided in the past. I don't know, maybe you come up with different figures.
Well, number one, they did it for extremely less money than we did.
You did a good job.
9 years.
Well, you definitely did.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We're trying to find ways to be more efficient with performing reevaluations, and even looking at some new methods going forward to be even tighter with that. Now, we'll say I don't know that we could do it on the same budget we did this last time around. That was less than I expected or planned on to be able to do. But you're right, it's a major undertaking every time you do a reevaluation. Therefore,
plus,
the more frequently you do it.
It takes a lot of time, a lot of papers.
Oh, absolutely.
The time is costly, too.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I think I did likely.
But it's something to think about.
Yeah. Indeed. At least like to hear the options.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the projected revenue may outweigh the cost.
That's right.
If everybody's on where they should be.
Yeah, I think we have a duty to look at it. Thank you for that. All right, do we have more questions about this presentation?
Got good job.
Out, that's all I'm saying.
I have some. So our original estimate that was given to the taxpayer when we were coming up with the bond proposal was 7.88 cents. And that was just to pay, or not just, but that was to pay for the $150 million of ABSS bonds and the, what was it, $39.4 million for the ABSS bonds. But, and I think that in your assumptions for that, you had included $2 million for the CIP plan, for the pay-as-you-go capital for the school system.
That's correct.
Right?
Yes.
And that's changed because this, now, since January, I guess, the school system's saying that $2 million a year isn't enough, that they need another $1.3 million. Is that right?
That's correct.
So, I think it's important that the public understands that what if we had included that $1.3 million in the original calculations where you came up with the 7.88? What if you in your assumptions had, instead of saying, I'm sorry if I'm asking you something that catches you unawares.
No, it's all right.
If in your assumptions where you built the 7.88 estimate, what if instead of $2 million, you had estimated $3.3 million for the PAYGO capital for the school system?
The proposed property tax increase would have been higher. I wouldn't want to guess, but you figure pennies in the plan, I think, worth about $1.4 million. So it would have been higher than 7.88 cents, maybe not quite an entire cent, but it would have been a higher estimate.
Close to nine.
Okay. And how many school buildings are there? There's 36 or 37? 36? And we included $250,000 a year for the county, right?
That's correct.
So are we going to have, before we vote on this budget, or before we vote on a budget that includes this tax increase to pay for these projects, are we going to have a list or an idea about what they'll be wanting to spend that $3.3 million a year on?
Yes, absolutely. I think that's what we are working with ABSS and the community college and our own facility plan to bring you. That's why we're looking at a 7-year period to say, what would be going on for the county, the school system, the community college over a 7-year period? That's when those reserves start building again. So when I come back to you with a proposed budget, I would imagine that the manager's recommended budget, that's where you would get information from all of us that say these are the plans for the dollars that are non-bond.
Okay, so let me see. Bear with me just a second. So $3.3 million divided by 36 schools, that would give them $91,600 and some dollars per school to do capital projects over the next, how many years?
Seven.
Over the next 7 years, so.
That is not a lot of money.
Per school.
This may be a question for ACC and ABSS, but do we know approximately how much land is needed for the new high school and how much land is needed for the public safety training center?
I think I'd defer to school system to see if they can answer that. High school.
Approximately 100 acres. We need to make sure we have at least 75 usable acres.
That's just for the high school?
Just for the high school.
I think
from the public safety training center, a minimum of 45 acres. More, better, but 45 acres.
Okay. Well, land's already there for that.
We'll work
out. Well, land's everywhere.
Yeah, the problem is getting a decent time to spend. But we're putting all those buildings in at our cost, and it's going to be on somebody else's property. Don't make sense to me. That is a bad, bad thing.
Beg your pardon, Bill.
If we're going to spend $12 million to build a building, I certainly don't want to put it on another person's property. And that's what they're proposing to do.
Lease versus purchase.
Yeah.
I want to take a minute to just praise the idea or say that I think the technical review committee model with having board oversight, I think that is a terrific idea. And I think it's great that it's already been formed and it's been meeting regularly to plan these kind of projects. I'm glad to know that is happening. There's a lot of communication and oversight and cooperation between the county and the school system and the county and ACC. To make sure that things proceed in a way that's orderly and well thought out. I think that's great. Pivotal to my support of this plan, this projection, is going to be having a good understanding of what is going to be done with that PAYGO project list with the school system. I think that people really want to see that and see what was expected to be done and see follow through with that.
I had planned to ask a question during the public comments, the commissioner's comments, but I think this is an appropriate time for me to ask it. Was there at any point pressure put on the ABSS administration to bring a zero increase budget to county commissioners for this year, for 19-20?
No, our discussions with the school system have been almost exclusively capital oriented. I think discussions about their operating budget have been primarily limited to the impacts that these bond projects will have. So, I think I would be remiss if I didn't say that the fact that they are proposing to bring a budget with no an operating budget with no increase is good. We know that's not. I understand that is not a long term plan, but no.
Well, I would commend the ABSS board and the administration for taking a hard look at it. I was at the work session where that was presented. I thought Dr. Benson and Jeremy Teeter did an excellent job of explaining why they tried to control that, taking into account the fact that the citizens of Alamance County stepped up to produce or to provide funding in the bonds. I know it was tough for y'all to take a hard look at your budget, but I commend you for taking that step. And I hope at no point you felt like you were under the gun to produce a zero-based budget.
No, sir, absolutely not. And really the driving factor here for us is making sure we have highly qualified teachers in all of our classrooms. And it's been a challenge for us in this past year with 13 classes that have long-term subs, and we'll likely have long-term subs for the remainder of the school year. So we want to make sure that we're doing everything to get a high qualified teacher in every space, and that was a big part of looking at redirecting some funds that are currently positioned to go to teachers that are not directly interacting with students.
Well, I know when I was still a candidate, I had an opportunity to meet with Dr. Benson, and subsequently to getting elected, to meeting with Mr. Teeter, and I was really impressed with their own personal philosophy about finance and the direction they try to take the ABSS in. So I look forward to working with them going forward, too.
I echo that. Y'all are doing a fine job. Really good. Does anybody have any more questions about the presentation today? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good information. Thank you.
Would you gentlemen like a recess, or are you ready to keep going? Okay. Then we have budget amendments. We have one regarding the jail. Sheriff, you presented the jail budget amendment.
Good morning, Commissioners. Before you this morning is a request for the Alamance County to move around $20,000 in total. $10,000 of that would come from the Sheriff's Federal Forfeiture Funds, and the other $10,000 would come from contingency funds. We would move those into the Sheriff's budget to be able to purchase cell phone lockers, signs, and carts so that we can store cell phones while citizens are in the court buildings. This was a request that the court system has made of the county.
I'll make a motion that we approve that.
I've got a question or two about it. Couldn't we put about a $10 sign at the door and say, leave your cell phones in the car? Just a question. I mean, or if they bring them out in the courtroom, fine them, we'll put some of that towards our budget for the school this year.
That's not a bad idea. What do you think, Sheriff?
Look. You're just helping out over there, right?
All I can say is the judges are fed up, people coming in the courtroom, sitting there texting or phoning.
There is a solution.
It definitely is a problem.
If they put a fine on it and take the phone, I guarantee you they won't do it once.
Yeah. I think the problem is a lot of people get dropped off and they don't have cars there. Because I think that is something, from my understanding, talked to the chief district court judge that there are people who don't have cars.
And put a payphone outside and then call on that, too.
Well, there's a safety issue there, too. People taking pictures in the courtroom with their phones. You can't always tell if somebody's doing that. I think that's one of the things that was brought up, wasn't it?
They
also tape stuff going right on things without people knowing they're being taped. That is a real problem.
I think that
that's a big problem federally.
There's been an issue of people having their picture taped, you know, like undercover agents who would come to testify, or other law enforcement people or witnesses, other people who come to participate in court proceedings who have no choice about to be there.
Like I said, if you confiscate that phone, charge them a fine, I bet you they'll quit.
Not sure we can legally confiscate that.
If they take it out in that courtroom, the judge has authority to have it confiscated.
Yeah, that judge.
So they don't know that they have it. They have it in their pocket. I think this is a good solution that kind of cut down on.
I think it's a little extra expense or something, but I don't know that we need to go. I can't support it. Where does this contingency money come out of?
So we have about $47,000 left in contingency. We plan that money for stuff like this that comes up that's not in anybody's budget. This was brought to our attention this fiscal year several months ago, so no one had planned for this. The drug money, the sheriff's agreed to split the cost. So we have, I think about $47,000 left in contingency.
I think this is something that the judges really wanted, and I think that our district attorney, Sean Boone, has been involved with developing this plan, if I'm not mistaken. And also, I think the clerk of court, Meredith Edwards, has been involved with it as well. So,
what's the total again?
$20,000.
Does that include staffing?
That's three sets of lockers and carts. For each court for the historic
for civil and for criminal. It puts a number of lockers that are, it costs like a quarter to get the keys, like a skate key kind of thing. You put a quarter in, you open it up, put the phone in, shut it, you get to carry the key with you. Then when you leave the court building, once you put the key back in, it stays in there and you get your
phone. So it's not staffed technically?
No, it's they have to put them in they'll have to put them in the lockers before they go through court security. Mm-hmm. Court security in all three buildings will be looking for phones too. So right now, you know, they have to be screened for weapons, so they empty their pockets. If they have a cell phone, they're going to be told, go put it in the locker. So the idea is to get them to put it in the lockers before they even attempt to go through security.
Is that setting up rearrangement? Because I think right as you come in the door in the building, you have your checkpoints to screen them. How is that going to work?
So at criminal and at civil, the lockers would be wheeled out each morning by the barracks. So right under the overhang in front of civil court near the sign, it would go there. And then at criminal court, it would be outside of the doors. So the device would be out there sitting out before you even come in. Because of the way it's set up, there wouldn't be any place for them to go before they went through security. So.
Mr.
Bob,
I agree with you. Some of that, however, I think you got a legal situation where you physically take the phone from you. But if I had my way, you wouldn't get in that courtroom and your britches hanging down to your room and dress
can,
like
can
a
we phone. Put a meter on these phone collectors?
I'll move that we approve the $20,000.
We already have a motion.
We have a motion and a second. So that's cool.
Let me ask a question. One more question. Is this being legislated at all?
No, not to my knowledge. I think the concern from the concern I've heard from judges and district attorneys have been folks recording or taking pictures of officers or ADAs in the courtroom or.
Well, I heard that, but I asked, was it being legislated from the state level at all?
Not to my knowledge. No.
Okay, I won't support it if it's not being legislated.
All right, we have a motion and a second then. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
All right. The ayes have it. 3-2. Thank you. Public speakers. So we have Tracy.
Does that include reporters, by the way?
Of course.
Not sure how it will be implemented. It's possible, yes.
Yeah, we've got to put Isaac's phone in the box.
Tracy Ovett.
You're so pleasant.
Come on up. Thomas Ovett, did I say that right?
It's okay. I'm the only one in North Carolina.
Ovett or Ovett? It's Ovett. Well, Gailey likes to make sure that people's names are pronounced right. It's not Galley.
How do you pronounce your last name?
Ovett.
Okay. Scala. Scala.
Ms. Ovett, before you get started, let me just take a minute. Usually, I'm sorry to call you up and make you stand there while I do this, but I want to talk about our rules. This is not directed toward you or any other person in this room or anybody out there. Just that we have rules for public comment. When people come in here and have something, the public comments period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Each speaker has 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. I don't intend to cut you off at the end of 3 minutes. I would anticipate giving you a chance to finish your thought or your sentence. But that is the rule that if you have 3 minutes to speak, there's no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. And we do have one other speaker signed up today besides you. If anybody's watching this on video, if you require an accommodation for a disabling condition, if you please contact our county clerk and let her know, we'll be glad to try to accommodate that. Public comment is not intended to require the board to answer any impromptu questions. Please address all comments to the board as a whole and not to individual commissioners. We don't allow discussions between speakers and members of the audience. Speakers, be courteous in your language and presentation. If you fail to abide by this requirement, that may result in forfeiture of the speaker's right to speak. If you have prepared written marks or supporting documents, you can leave a copy of those with our clerk and they'll be incorporated into our minutes. Please don't discuss any of the following members which concern the candidacy of any person seeking public office, matters which are the subject of public hearings, and matters which are closed session matters. And then there's a few other things, and that public comment policy is available to be reviewed as revised in January when we made two public comment periods. That's on our county website. So, Ms. Ovid.
Before she starts, can I interrupt just one second? There is a thing in our book here that has her
remarks on it.
That you're making. We have a copy of those.
That is actually a letter that I started with my campaign in December. The actual remarks are on the thick packet that I gave each of you.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
So if I read quickly, you each have a packet to review.
Right.
Well, thank you very much for providing that. That's very helpful. All right. Please start.
Okay. I'm here to speak about biker poker run or benefit ride awareness in Alamance County. Drinking and riding motorcycles and charity events have taken place statewide for years. These runs can contain 25 to 250 motorcycles or more at one time. Entry fees go from $10 to $25 a bike, and it's called a poker run because you draw card hands at each stop. These are 750 plus pounds of motorcycle, not including passengers, riding side by side on public roads. Most, but not all, are organized to be moving parties going from bar to bar to bar, drinking and riding as they go through the stops and returning back to the home bar. They do have ride captains and blockers who are part of the organizing group, and these blockers do block traffic cross sections illegally. No one can do that unless you're trained or law enforcement. These rides are called poker runs as they draw cards at the beginning, 3 to 5 bar stops into the ride, and ride at the end of the venue and pull the final card. Cash prizes are awarded for the best and worst hand. Depending on the conditions and charity licensing, the ALE considers this illegal gambling. Also, at 2 beers a stop from start to end, this can be 8 to 10 beers in 3 hours. Alamance County has 3 large benefit rides: the Miles for Mutts that benefits the Humane Society, the Tricky Ricky ride, and the Apple Fest. And there are more being created, such as Team K, as breast cancer awareness, and these are all mostly by the same group of people. I feel that these rides could be designed much safer and differently without affecting the charity aspect of the benefit. No one has the right to knowingly plan a bar-to-bar motorcycle crawl charity benefit that endangers themselves and others. Due to the loophole in the existing DWI laws, law enforcement has never been able to stop these events. Officers are aware that the bike operators are drinking, but cannot stop the event before they leave the venue where the poker run begins without witnessing an infraction. Bikers, bar owners, and event organizers are aware of this loophole and they take full advantage. To further assist with the limited liability from injuries or deaths, most organizers require the participants to sign a waiver or release form so that they will not be held personally liable. Current DWI law will only charge the bartender that overserved the participant if and when they are caught riding intoxicated. And given the above information, what I'm asking the commissioners is help from. I recognize that any action is outside of the regulatory control of the county commissioners. So I'm wanting to make you aware of the poker runs, driving and drinking, and would like to seek your help in lobbying the state government for new legislation that would outlaw poker runs and establish legislation for benefit organizers and bar owners that hold these runs involving alcohol from stops and other bars responsible. I feel that they need to be charged as a felony due to the premeditated planning and direct disregard for the safety of all North Carolinians. Also, I've reached out.
Your 30 seconds.
Oh, okay. Also, what's even more disconcerting is at one of these bars where these rides are, there is an election party given for the new Superior Court Judge, Andy Hanford.
Ms. Ovid, that's a new thought, so.
Yeah.
That's,
You're over your time.
We've got that.
So, we appreciate you providing the written materials. Thank you. Very helpful. Thank you so much. All right. Dr. Ulickney.
Good morning. Good to see you again.
My name is Gary Ulickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I'm here today as a representative of the No Snow Camp Mine Citizens Coalition. On January 11th, 2018, the Alamance County Planning Office issued an intent to construct a permit to Snow Camp Property Investments for the purpose of constructing and operating a crushed stone quarry in southern Alamance County. According to Alamance County HIDO, it states in Article 4, Section 4, intent to construct permits shall be valid from 1 year from the date of issuance. Expired permits due to inactivity shall require reapplication and review. In the event that the applicant must reapply for a permit, it shall require a fee to be paid at the time of the filing of the application. Nowhere in the HIDO does it indicate that permits only expire from inactivity. It says very clearly that permits are valid for 1 year. This is reinforced in comments from Libby Hodge to the applicant during the application process. It is not qualified. There are no conditions stipulated. It then goes on to say that permits which expire from lack of activity need to be reapplied, but it does not indicate that lack of activity is necessary for the permit to expire. They simply expire in 1 year. The permit granted to Snow Camp Property Investments should have expired on January 11, 2019. On January 9th, 2 days before the permit was set to expire, the applicant brought in a bulldozer and began construction on a road entrance to the property, the intent evidently being to accomplish some activity in order to avoid the expiration of their permit. However, the applicant was cited by the state as being out of compliance in order to cease and desist and to repair damage done to the property. Because illegal activity cannot constitute legitimate satisfaction of a legal requirement, the activity at the site cannot satisfy the requirement for activity under the Alamance County HIDO. Alamance Aggregates permit should have expired on January 11th, requiring them to reapply. However, this has not happened. Neither the County Planning Office nor the Board of Commissioners has made any move to revoke the permit, nor made any public statement as to why the permit has not been revoked. The county attorney has indicated that, in his opinion, the permit has not expired, but has not addressed the fact that the HIDO clearly states that permits are valid for 1 year, period, nor has he cited any language in the HIDO that would support that opinion. It'd be prudent for the county to get a second opinion from an unbiased expert to either support or refute the county attorney's position. So has the permit expired or has it not? Clearly, Snow Camp Property Investments thought the permit was about to expire. Otherwise, they would not have risked being cited by the state by hastily getting some activity going 2 days before the expiration date. We hereby call on the Board of Commissioners to require the Planning Office to either expire the permit as required under the HIDO or to publicly explain why they refused to do so. Thank you very much. I got copies here for you all.
Good.
Thank you, Dr. Litton.
Okay. Thank you. Somebody came in late that would like to speak, John, if possible.
May I speak?
Oh, okay, sure. What's your name?
John Oakes.
Okay, sure, Mr. Oakes.
John, it's a pleasure to see you again. How you doing?
Yeah.
Good to see everybody. Thanks to video, I get to stay informed at home, and I don't have to feel the tensions in the room. So I'm always grateful, though, for the opportunity to speak. I don't like public speaking; very uncomfortable. Brother Russell, the sheriff in the parking lot. And I know I'd wind up in the intensive care unit if I had to do that. I'm here basically today because it had came to my attention, or come to my attention, that there was going to be a discussion today, and I apologize for being unprepared in reference to the dispute between a few neighbors in the county in reference to discharging firearms. I like to start everything with the premise that when I speak, I'm looking up to people, and not talking down to people. I like to tell my atheist friends and Christian friends and family members that whether we agree or disagree, I totally understand relativism, existentialism, and all that stuff. But I'm coming from a good place. And I have a Christian worldview, but I don't believe in unicorns and Disneyland. And I always like to tell everybody, we read Socrates and Plato. I would encourage you to read Romans chapter 12, Galatians 5:22. If these things are real in reality, there's real hope. And there's civility, because we all used to come from a more common denominator, which in my lifetime I've noticed that's getting further and further apart. But always when I speak, it's never from a hostile perspective. But the reason I came today, and appreciate that budget presentation, because now I know a lot more than I did before I walked in here, because I'm one of the guys paying those taxes. And
come from a very humble background. My dad used to say, do what you can do until you can do better. Take care of your own family, your friends. If you're blessed, reach out and help everybody. And I want to do what I can. I spent a year over at Williams High School. I should have been a policeman instead of a substitute teacher coach, because there's a lot of things going on in the public school system you can't fix with dollars. And getting fixed at home, 80% of your problems, that's where you fix it. But anyway, I've got a minute left, so I'll be brief. Two neighbors having the dispute over discharging firearms. I wished I was one of those neighbors so I could get acquainted with my neighbor and say, hey, what am I doing that's offensive to you or you're not feeling safe with? And I would like to reach out to them and say, hey, how can I change that behavior? Because I've been around guns my whole life. So my dad was World War II, 13. I've been shooting, walking down railroad tracks. Keep chamber open. Don't have that gun loaded, you get into the county. But as you guys discern these topics and make these decisions, I would ask you to use rational thought. You know, I don't represent Durham Pistol and Rifle Club, but I am a member there. Have been for a long time, because we want the good guys to be proficient, right? Because the bad guys don't care. They just get access to a gun illegally and discharge it. So as we say this and you guys look to resolve these issues at a practical level and amongst neighbors, first place I ask the neighbors to look at each other and say, how can I make you feel safe and what can I do to accommodate your concerns about the safety of your children with a firearm? I totally get that. And then at the same time, I'd ask you guys not to compete on the Second Amendment. And I hope y'all consider that. Okay. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. Sorry I was late.
Thank you, John.
Thank you very much. Okay. So having the second public speaker's comment time at the end of the agenda is a little bit new. So we'll have the county manager's report, and then we'll use the commissioner's comment time after that to respond to public speakers. So we don't do it twice. So not a lot of back and forth. But that's all right. So, Mr. Hagan.
All I have is just remind you that the January 2019 financial info is in this packet. So you can certainly take a look at it. And let us know if you have any questions, but that's all I have.
Thank you. All right, do we have any commissioners' comments about anything, including the public speakers that we've heard from?
Tracy, where are you from?
Yes, sir. I am originally from Winston-Salem, and I moved down here in 2007. I lived down here until 2016, at which time my only surviving family member is my mother, who is 75 and still in Winston. So I had to move back to Winston, but I work here. So I'm here 5 days a week. I drive 65 miles one way every day, 5 days a week, because I love my job, but I also love my mom. So that is my connection to the county. I have friends here. I come down on the weekends and do things. So I'm out, and I also ride a motorcycle.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I appreciate you coming and talking about that. It is something that people need to be aware of, and we won't comment
that's
back.
Okay. That's fine. I also have given this presentation to Forsyth County Commissioners, and we'll be going before Guilford County as well.
Yeah. And it is concerning to how much is drank at some of those runs. I've been on a couple. Of course, I didn't drink and then I quit doing it because I got a little scared myself. And anyhow, thanks for making awareness to that.
You're very welcome. Thank you for listening.
Anybody else? Mr. Albright, Dr. Ulickney has raised the question about whether or not the Alamance Aggregates permit has expired. Do you want to respond to that?
It has not expired.
And how can you substantiate that? If it on its face, it would have expired, I guess, on January 11th.
Well, they spent a lot of money hiring experts and pursuing their state mining permit, which is the second step in the process. So they have just not done nothing. And the incident he referred to about the bulldozer and the work, I checked that out with the state myself. They put a pipe in the ditch and covered it with gravel so their surveyors could access their property to conduct surveys. They're not mining out there.
And was that survey activity something that they had a legal right to be doing?
Yes, they have to do that. They own the property. They have to show where their buffers are. They have to show where their equipment's going to be and where their operation's going to be on that 400-acre tract of land.
Do you happen to know when they filed their permit with their application for a permit with the state?
No, I don't, but I know they've spent a lot of time and money with their experts.
And to your knowledge, are they waiting now for the state to issue a permit to them?
I think it's in the hands of the Mining Commission. That's where it is now.
But, so they're in kind of a holding pattern, right?
Well, they're waiting on the Mining Commission. I don't know if they're modifying their permits. I know they're talking with the attorneys for the Citizens Coalition, who are represented by attorneys. So I think it's a little disingenuous to take action against a mining company and then say they're not doing anything. But that's just my personal opinion on it.
When was the time frame of the installation of this pipe, I guess? Because I would have thought they would have had their surveys prior to submitting an application.
I don't know.
Dr. Ulakney, please don't have this conversation.
I don't know the exact date, but the state said if they had put it 50 feet down from their proposed driveway, they wouldn't be in violation. So many logging companies do the same thing. They throw a metal pipe in the ditch. They cover it with gravel. They put their wooden pallets down, put their trucks on, and then at the end of the job, they take it up. So
Mr. Albright, if our county permit expires after a year, but in your opinion, if the company has filed for a state permit during that year and they're just waiting to hear back from the state, can you describe a situation where they would actually, the permit would expire? Is that they have a year from when they get their permit from the county, they have a year to apply with the state?
No, it says inactivity. That's the word used in the ordinance, inactivity. If there's no activity, if they've done nothing, then that would be the definition of inactivity. And but they have done something.
Who determines that activity, I guess, is a question I guess you're asking.
Well, it's a fact. It's just a question of fact. Did they hire a geologist? Did they apply for the mining permit? Have they done the next step in the process? Because remember, once this is a two-step process for us. There's their permit to construct, which they're in now. Then there's their permit to operate. After the state mining company or mining department issues the permit to operate, then they come back to us. And we look at our ordinance to make sure that the distance and spacing has been met and that the appropriate buffers are in place. Then they get their permit to operate. So they've done the first stage legally.
Have we been in contact with the state mining group that's approving this and so forth? I mean, have we had any kind of direct contact with them just to say what has been done or when has it been done? Or
I have not contacted them. I don't think any of that information is public record. I'll be happy to try and get you an update.
It'd be interesting.
I can get you an update from their attorney.
An update to see what really is. I mean, we're talking about something we don't know about either because we've not contacted
him. Well, let me do this. Let me talk to their attorney and see if he can give us a chronological listing of what has been done from the date the permit was approved to today.
That'd be great.
I think that'd be reasonable and useful to know what steps that they've taken.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
In reliance on being issued the permit from the county.
As I understood what you said, Mr. Albright, the timing of the request of the permit application to the state was within the period, was required to be within the period prior to the expiration of our permit.
Yes, that's correct.
That,
they started.
That continues our permit. Is what
right. They began the process, and they require state approval because the county doesn't have the personnel or the expertise to talk about air pollution, water pollution, mining, use of explosives, right. Those kind of things. The state does. So once you get the permit to move forward, then you make your application with these various agencies, which they have done. And after all that's been approved, if it gets approved, there's no guarantee they're going to get a state mining permit. I don't know what the requirements are for that. But if they are approved, then they come back to us for the operating permit. And we go back and look and make sure their buffers are what they're supposed to be, and the center of operations is where it's supposed to be. And if all of that's done, then they get their operation permit from the county, and they can proceed with their mining. But I'll get that, I'll contact their lawyer, and I'll see if I can...
Peace of mind, maybe, is to know where we are and what that is, and I think it would help the residents to kind of know what is going on, and I would think we would have authority to ask of it.
We certainly can. I'll ask him.
How long was it a mine prior?
Pardon?
How long was it a mine prior?
Mine?
It never has been.
Prior? I mean, there are several mines that have been down there and closed. In fact, the property issue is down, I think it's on Mine Quarry School Road.
Yeah.
Is one of the roads down there, so it's been a center for mining.
But that particular piece of land never has been.
I don't believe it ever has.
That particular acreage has?
Has not.
I thought I read where it has.
There's some close by that have.
What, now, forgive me for, yeah, these letters are very technical and very lawyer-istic or listic, whatever. What did Colonial or the pipelines, in lay terms, say about the distance from where the activity was going to take place, so forth and so on?
In lay terms, they don't have any concerns.
They didn't have any concerns?
They don't have any concerns. They pointed me to their quarry in Guilford County, which is right beside the tank farm. And their line runs beside the tank farm, and there's a quarry next to their line in Guilford that they've not experienced any problems with.
Anything else? All right. Do you have any comments about anything else? Are we done? Okay. All the business of the board being concluded will be adjourned.
County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.